Hi, everybody. My name is Eric Hines. I'm curator of film Museum of the Moving Image. I welcome you to today's edition of the Reverse Shot Happy Hour. It is Wednesday, September 23rd. We are in autumn. We started these back in spring, I would say mid-spring. So it's a pleasure for us to be joined by you several seasons in, and we hope you are enjoying yourselves. We hope you're having a good spring, and if you're in New York, that you're enjoying New York Film Festival, or if you're afar watching from home. But in general, thank you for this time finding us here and for supporting us at Museum of the Moving Image and Reverse Shot during this time. Thanks for joining us live. If you are also joining us on YouTube later on, thanks for catching up to us. You can find us every Wednesday here at 5 p.m. Eastern. Just want to welcome you to this week's edition and bring on our hosts for the Reverse Shot Happy Hour. Reverse Shot's been a longstanding publication for Museum of the Moving Image. But also has been active since 2003, and was formed by two of the three people you're about to see. And Farihah Zaman, the third person, has been associated with Reverse Shot nearly as long. So let's bring out the editors and founders of Reverse Shot, Michael Koresky and Jeff Reichert, and filmmaker and longtime contributor, Farihah. Hi, Farihah.
Hello.
Hi, Eric.
I appreciated the musical choice this week, but it's so hard using Zoom to fluidly go from song to program for two different reasons, so everybody knows. One is that the song can't be played on YouTube without us getting shut down, so there has to be a rough break for the editor to know what to include, what not to include. Also, there's just no way of fading in or fading out if you're sharing screen. But it's bizarre. Anyway.
It wasn't too abrupt. It worked.
It wasn't too abrupt.
And that was okay. Thank you for that.
Maybe we'll get so used to the aesthetics of Zoom streaming that sometime in the future, I'm not going to jinx it by suggesting when I think that might be. We'll be like, oh, this transition was too smooth. What do you mean I immediately see people on screen? What do you mean I can play the song out to the end? Feels wrong.
I'll accept that. I think that's
good. It's just the way that it is. It's like the short version of that.
Oh, for those who don't know, that was Wuthering Heights by Kate Bush. I think we should tell people sometimes what the song is.
Huh. That's a good idea. All the time. Why sometimes? Is that like an emotionally withholding thing? Like today, you don't deserve it. I'm not going to tell you.
My sometimes was like, you know, clearly facetious. We should do it all the time.
We should do it when we remember, I think is where the sometimes comes from. I think that's fair. You've earned it. Thank you for joining us on a Wednesday. And that was Wuthering Heights by Kate Bush, who's a very favorite artist of mine.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think of all three of us.
I sometimes try to do that song at karaoke, / used to try to sometimes do that at karaoke. I don't know if like singing it in your bathroom alone counts as karaoke, but no one but Kate Bush can sing that song.
And Brian Bellavarak of Janus Films.
that I'd like to see.
In case you're watching, Brian.
Well, we're really excited about today's show because we are going to bring out in a little while Kirsten Johnson, who I think most people know is the director of the fabulous Cameraperson, which was our number eighth movie of the decade, our number eight movie of the decade that Farihah wrote about. Mm-hmm. I think she's got a new movie out in just, I don't know, 8 or 9 days on Netflix called Dick Johnson Is Dead, which we've all had a chance to catch up with. And you know, sometimes with the show, we have an idea of what we want to talk about, and then we start to think about people who, you know, could sort of speak to that question. Other times we have an amazing person on, and we're like, what would be a great thing to talk about with Kirsten Johnson? So we were having this discussion last week, and Farihah immediately was just like, oh, obviously, Catharsis would be great. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about why that pairing sort of intrigued you.
Sure. I guess the like facetious short answer is like, cause she can handle it. Not everybody can handle it. And I feel that she can speak to it so well, as evidenced by anytime I'm in her presence, I'm like, suddenly we've delved really deep into sort of some like emotional response to my family circumstances in a way that I've never talked about before, not even with a therapist. Like, I think that she just brings that out in people. So maybe it was a little bit of a subconscious response to the relationship that we have. And I think, you know, something that applies very much to her abilities as a filmmaker is that quality of how she makes people feel and the conversations that she inspires. But we were also thinking a lot of, in particular about her new film, Dick Johnson is Dead, because it is coming out very soon on Netflix, I think early October.
October 2nd.
October 2nd. I know dates. Okay. You know, something that connected for me about this film and Cameraperson is like a way of trying to understand something very personal through external mechanism, through these like processes that that are self-designed, because things like loss and illness are so massive that it's really, you need to find a way to figure out how to deal with it. I'll let Kirsten talk about Dick Johnson. I was about to explain a little bit more, but maybe she can speak to why that film in particular has a lot to do with catharsis. And interestingly, catharsis in advance of a loss, in an expected loss, which I found so totally unique, and a way of like trying to understand and deal with death that American culture is not very comfortable with, which is like, it's gonna happen. It's happening. It's happening. We're all, it's an impending march towards death. But it also made me think about how, like, we've talked a lot, I think, because, you know, we can't help but like respond to extraordinary circumstances and COVID life and quarantine life about films that comfort us and like bring us joy. And I think that films that we watch because they are cathartic can involve those things, but doesn't necessarily have to. It's like its own animal. And I also started thinking about how everybody's search for catharsis is totally unique to them. And when you hear it from your friends, they're like, well, I was feeling really crummy and I just needed to lean into it. So I watched Catfish for 18 hours. I feel like you always get this feeling when you know the person of like, that sounds right. Like, that's so you. Of course, Michael, you stayed up late into the night watching like C horror movies from 1989 on Hulu or whatever. So yeah, I
was scared.
Yeah, I was very curious to talk to Kirsten about like that process and seeking out that kind of, it's an engaging with and release of emotion, as opposed to comfort can sometimes sound like an avoidance, mm-hmm. Or a distraction. So I want to talk to someone about that who I think is very expert, both as a filmmaker and as a film lover.
I just also wanted to add, just to verify what you were saying earlier about Kirsten's ability to draw out emotional moments, not necessarily just on screen, but in life. I just recall, so I had written about Cameraperson for Film Comment magazine, and this was back in, I guess, 2016. And I had never met her. I don't write about things you know, made by friends or people that I know. So I felt completely open to being very emotional about it and just kind of digging into the themes that I perceived, and it was just whatever. But then I ran into her at the end of the year at I believe it was like the Film Society Film Comment Luncheon. And I always get very intimidated by people at first. Like, I just always assume that, you know, the person I'm talking to is much smarter than me and this will go like down in flames. But like within 20 seconds of talking to her, I was so disarmed. And we ended up, this is before the meal was served, we were just kind of off in the corner talking. I ended up spilling my guts basically about my whole life, my relationship with my father, who we have had similar experiences with our parents and Alzheimer's. And it was actually probably the most wonderful conversation I've ever had at that kind of an event, which are usually, you know, industry bullshit. So it was an unforgettable moment. So seeing this new film was something that I've been looking forward to for a long time, and I'm extremely moved by it, and I can't wait to talk to her about it.
Yep. Should we show the trailer?
Yeah.
Let me try a little AV wizardry. So let's see if this works here. I'm going to try to share my screen. And here's this. Okay, you should be all seeing that now.
It's happening.
It's happening. Excellent. Okay.
Just the idea that I might ever lose this man is too much to bear. He's my dad.
Let's start walking. Just start walking to me. That's fantastic.
I suggested we make a movie about him dying. He said yes.
He kills me multiple times.
Actions!
Resurrected dad.
Yeah.
Resurrected dad.
But now it's upon us, the beginning of his disappearance.
The thing I hate most about my memory loss is that it hurts people's feelings.
You know that you woke up in the middle of the night last night. You got fully dressed. Do you remember any of that?
No.
Yeah.
What can we do about that?
I don't know.
Everybody has to sort of prepare because everybody dies.
I love life too much for that.
Oh man, sweetie, your father is a wreck.
It's just inevitable and a part of who we all are.
Yeah. The fact that he's willing to keep doing this,
what he's doing for you with love.
He's doing it for me as well. Yeah, he'll do anything for me.
Can you just like put one arm up against the wall? Like, yeah, that's nice.
That is brutal.
Cool. Well,
it's rated PG-13.
PG-13. Eric, could you to join us?
Oh. 25 years ago, Steven Spielberg opened the door to Joel.
Yeah.
Inside those doors.
Spielberg, I don't know what he's doing here.
Sorry, that got a little
out of hand. He's an artist, you know, sometimes he just goes off in directions we can't even. So good to see you.
Welcome.
Hi there.
Hi, I'm all about the grooming, of course. Delighted to see everyone so coiffed. Yeah, we forgot to mention that Kirsten's also a style icon, and I did put on a special jacket for you.
I feel the specialness. I feel the camaraderie of our jackets.
Yeah.
Michael, you know, you and me both, that conversation was one of those, like, how did this happen? It was such a, like, straight to the bone marrow conversation in the midst of schmoozing. And, you know. That's what I'm into. So Jeff, you and I have not yet done that.
Whenever.
It might happen tonight.
Just me and Jeff, I'm ready.
That's because Jeff has no family issues or insecurities.
Harder to coax out, perhaps.
I don't do insecurities. I do love people. I do all love and compassion. Hi.
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 Beautiful, awesome. Your whole scene here. This is my first appearance at the, you know, MOMI shot, reverse shot, extravaganza. I like the music. I like the chatter. I like, you know, it's a scene. And I see all these beautiful people who are here with us. And it's just nice, nice community that you have happening here.
Yeah, and the people who join every week are real film lovers. And I think are excited to have, you know, someone like you come and speak. I know that we've been very excited about having you. It comes up constantly.
Yeah.
And I think, Kirsten, like part of the reason that many of us have had this experience, and like, A, you don't do like small talk, which I love, but it's also amazing to see like in making work that's so personal and true to you, it actually has the effect of completely making people feel open about, like everybody can, you know, see their experiences in your films. Like it's that magical thing where in expressing the most you, you've opened yourself up to so many other people.
Mm-hmm. Whew. You know, I just had a day of press conversations and it's real. Like, it, there's definitely what's happening with this movie. Like, I, you know, haven't talked about it since Sundance and True Falls. Sort of the most, both of them, like, incredibly glorious experiences. Sundance, I got to share with my dad. He was there, and people were like, oh my God, he's really here. You know, like, I caught him at the end of one Sundance screening. There's like a line of ladies, like, lined up to hug him. And I was like, Dad, what's happening? He's like, I don't know how this happened, but I feel really good about it.
He's like, come on in.
Like, this is working for me.
He is delightful in the movie and outside of it. So,
well, I think he's really, you know, been just kind of enjoying himself in the experience of this whole thing all along. And now with the pandemic, we're separated from each other. We're communicating by phone, but he jumped in on several of the calls that I had to do with journalists, like, just call in to, like, make sure you know I love you, you know, like, so he is, like, in the process, and I think will be in the process as we go forward to the release. But, you know, it's interesting to hear you all, not Jeff, because we haven't had our moment yet, but the two of
maybe
you,
now,
but to speak about this, our experiences of, you know, just cutting to the quick. And that is what, even as a child, I would look over and see my dad at a party would be in a corner and someone would be spilling their guts to him. And I think about it as, like, what my father allowed, you know, that there was nothing someone could say to him that he did not accept as their truth. And then obviously he'd work from there if he was dealing with a person who was struggling with schizophrenia or, you know, but he took at face value what people said to him about their lives. And I think, you know, I wanted to be a psychiatrist for a hot minute until I took biology in college. And then I was like, this is not for me. But obviously filmmaking is for me. And the quiet space that having a camera creates, the listening space that a camera can create, is sort of a school for me.
I wanted to say that I have to admit that I was as scared of watching this movie as I was anticipating it or looking forward to it. I mean, I was looking forward to it because I thought the concept was amazing, and I thought, and I loved Cameraperson so much. But just my own personal experiences, I was nervous that it was going to dredge up certain emotions, you know, because, you know, as we're talking about today, there are some catharses that we want to dive into and that we look for. And then there are others that we might not really always invite all the time. And the particular experience, you know, just, you know, so people know I'm talking about, my father died of early onset Alzheimer's. So my relationship with him was also such that I was a bit young when that happened. So I wouldn't have been able to create anything remotely like what you were able to create for your father and to investigate your relationship with him when I was in my, you know, early 20s through my 20s. And so I thought that I would actually be strangely jealous of watching this film, that you were able to do this project, and that it would also remind me too much of certain things that, that I had gone through. And while there were moments, the conversation with him about not being able to drive anymore, that's something that we all go through, right? Yeah. That conversation has to happen at some point. It was very difficult. My father was a car nut. But other than that, I'm not here to talk about myself. I'm here to talk about this film. Other than that, I actually found it to be an incredibly joyous, open-hearted, and helpful experience. So thank you for that. And then also, I was just curious about how you were, this is like the biggest question, right? But how are you negotiating all these registers making this? You must have been racked with doubt throughout this whole process as much as wanting to dive right in, because it's such a tricky subject.
One, what kind of car did your father drive?
Well, his favorite was his Grand National Super Sport, which is... which he got through work, because, like, they would kind of, he was a traveling salesman, so they would pay, they would go in on, like, more than half for his car payments. So
it's the car as like the pleasure of driving it and the presentation of self, right? Mm-hmm. So the car is identity, the car is freedom. Yeah, and you know, as viewers will learn about my father, he has no toes. So cars were also for him, like the way he could be fast and powerful and able differently than he could in his body. I'm moved that you overcame your fear of the film. And, you know, I definitely felt fear while making it and feel fear now that someone will watch it and it will not be okay for them, you know? And, you know, insanely, like one of my big fears is like, when am I gonna meet the person whose father died in one of the ways that my dad dies in the film? And it literally happened on screening number 2 at Sundance. And a woman came up and said, you know, my father died falling down the stairs. And my son tried to kill me and push me down the stairs. We later learned he was schizophrenic. And I think this movie is one of the funniest movies I've ever seen. And we were there like hugging each other. And I said, how is this possible? Like I was so afraid for someone like you watching this movie. And she said, you know, like, we already have the pain. What the pain already exists. And what you are acknowledging is the existence of the pain. And also just like this huge, just like, you can't have me. Like, you have me, but you can't have me. You know, this defiance, the defiance of the loss, the defiance of the pain. And I just was like, I was like, I am so grateful to you because, you know, I know that this film is in transgressive territory. I know that it's in risky territory. And I certainly remember when my mom first got Alzheimer's, a friend sat me down and was like, you've got to watch Dutiful Daughter. And I started to watch it and I was like, are you kidding me? I don't want to see this future. And so, you know, I think there are many of us in our well-meaning moments when we think we understand what someone else needs in their pain, and we are so terribly wrong, you know, so terribly wrong. So, you know, that sort of feeling that quality of risk about what I'm asking of people, in some ways, I wanted to give people signals right up front. Like, you know, this is messed up. My dad's alive and I'm calling this movie Dick Johnson is Dead. Like, it's messed up from jump. You know it from the title. You know it from the PG-13 rating. you know, and like camera person, I was signaling, you know, like when I say these are the images that have marked me, you know, and I am wondering still. They're like small signals, but they're signals that like protect yourself if you need to. But it's also this engagement with, you know, what we know, Farihah, is you can't protect yourself from certain things come at you that are impossible to imagine and impossibly painful, and then you have to cope with them. So I was really interested in that sort of energy between, like, we've all been given warning. We're all human. We're all going to die. And yet all of us are in denial about it, right?
Yeah.
And the pandemic has like changed all the warning signals so that suddenly like, oh, the realization for one person that like, I'm in a vulnerable group, even though I've never thought of myself as a vulnerable person. Or, you know, it's like, I'm born in 1965, 54 years old. Like, I'm officially in a vulnerable group. Like, who knew, you know, these things, where you have to reckon with like, oh, I really am as old as I am. Or, you know, death can come up at any of us. And then, you know, this realization like that death keeps coming for some of us in an out of measure way. Yeah. And what do we do with the sort of shame and horror of that, that we're not remedying that, we're like doubling down on it, right? So, you know.
It makes me think
like,
about,
you know, catharsis is a great word to work with tonight. But I think like, you know, fear, when you have known real pain, you do need to protect yourself. So then what does someone like me do, knowing there is like extreme pain out there, and yet I want to open up, I want to connect into it, right?
And so you make this film.
Yes, I do. And I have to say, I'm making like amazing color temperature shifts here. Just by like moving, I'm like magic, green. I was like, I'm like having so much fun.
It's like playing a theremin.
With process, right? I think images are relationships. I think as all of you know, and that they're ongoing relationships. Yeah. And I think cinema is a time machine. And so, you know, making this film, I am making it now with you. My father's still making it with me. We have a thing that can go out and leave the space for other people. So, you know, there's just all this like magic, freaky stuff going on in the conversations I'm having with people about it already. But basically, since we're all filmmakers and we all love process talk, this process was very specifically designed, and its design came out of making Cameraperson and came out of some of the things we learned from Cameraperson and some of the things that were like magic, weird, like how did that happen? Like we don't know how certain things happen in Cameraperson, and so we're like interested in that, okay, what do we not know about why that added up to something? So, you know, with this team of trusted people who all know, you know, my dad some people have known him for decades, love him, you know, as well as people I'd never worked with before, we said, okay, how can we know that we will not know anything about this film? How can we build that into the process? Because I know that about dementia. I know that about death. I know that it is profoundly unexpected, like on a moment by moment basis. And sort of the things, you know, Jeff, to get there with you, right? Like when we do camera work, what happens is we get blindsided. Mm-hmm. There is a moment in the course of every day, no matter how long, how boring, some strange, and it may be like the tiniest thing and it will never be in any movie, but we're like, my understanding of the world has just been altered. Mm-hmm. And it will happen every day of shooting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so that, like knowing that's gonna happen, That's what we do with documentary, is we enter this complex, unknowable world, you know, that I'm convinced is like, whoa, how many dimensions of time are there, right? Like I'm totally up in the quantum physics with this stuff because I've experienced it enough times. Like, oh, you know, there are other people here.
Yeah.
And I can feel them. And somehow things are happening, right? So knowing that if you shoot staying open, then mystery arrives and you know, you'll get it just barely. Like you probably missed it most of the time, but once in a while you have like a little fragment of it or something, you know, and it's like the snow falling off the window in Kathy Lecter's house of her, you know, her mother shows up and like, I whip over, whip pan. It's like, I barely got it, but you all like, it happened. That was coexistent time. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So okay, we take that, we move forward with it, what's happening with my dad, and at whatever pace it happens, whatever happens, I keep filming when I think it matters to me, which is very little, actually. And then how do we bump up against that like most unexpected moment that we have recorded, the imagined appearance of his death? And that we do through something invented, something built. Mm. And so we have no idea what this film's gonna look like. It doesn't matter. And all I'm doing is trying to keep my father alive. That's all I'm doing. And so, you know, things like going into the sound mix with Pete Horner 8 months early with an unfinished film. Nobody does this.
Yeah.
Right? And saying, can you show me the 7 different sounds you can create at this moment that will make this death tonally different? So we get to hear, oh, here's the comic version of it. Here's the version that like gut punches you. Here's the version that I don't know why just made me cry.
Mm-hmm. How did you choose the deaths?
So there's no choosing, right? The deaths chose us, right? I mean, this is the thing, I think, like, this is what I want to really, like, try to get out there to all of you. It's like, it is an acceptance of total out of controlness, an acceptance of inevitable failure, an acceptance of not knowing. The engagement with that is what will give you back the joy you could not imagine. I couldn't imagine that this making this movie would give me joy. I was desperate that it would. Mm-hmm. I was desperate to get a laugh. All I wanted was one big laugh out of this movie. Like, and we kept not having it, right? So we had to keep building and rebuilding it in the search of a great laugh. So just to say, like, for all of us as filmmakers, I felt it was small. I questioned whether it was worth making. I was sort of horrified with this, like, for the first time in my life, I have a budget, but suddenly I have, you know, the center of the story can't do the things that I can afford to do. Mm. You know, so it's like, I had a vision of putting him on an ice floe, but like, it would have killed him. I had the money to do it. I had the team all lined up. We'd scouted the ice floe. And then I had to admit, like, as we got closer to doing it, like, we can't do this. I'll kill my dad for real, you know?
Yeah.
So that, like, the juiciness of that process, and with someone, you know, like Nels, who'd been through, Nels Bangerter, the great editor, who had been through Cameraperson with me, like Katie Chevigny, like Maureen Ryan, like Marilyn Ness, who are all people who, like, know the craft. And also, like, we've done this long enough. We want to have a good time together. We know this is going to hurt. So how much fun can we have together? And how can we, like, see all of the people who are part of this? See the stunt people, see the sound people. You know, that those were all the wishes. That's all we were wishing. That was the process. And so it was really magical.
I love hearing you talk about this moment. This moment that always happens. And I do think particularly in making documentaries, because I'm surprised by the number of people who do doc because they have a desire for control in life. And so, maybe I relate, maybe I don't, but so you actually need circumstances in which you know you don't have it because it's so extreme that nothing else would jolt you out of it, right? But I think that there's a lot of talk about the camera as a mitigator and a kind of like blind that's drawn across your emotional experience.
Yeah.
And what you're talking about is actually that it's like, it just adds layers to your emotional experience. And I think this is one of the things that I think Cameraperson articulates so well without ever saying it, is that like, you are also a human who's experiencing all of these moments, all of the things that you film, regardless of what it's for or what movie it's going to go in or who sold it or whatever, is an experience that you have lived, and that is your diary. I think that what's so, like, still, that I still think about with Dick Johnson is like, but you're imagining the future of your personal life, or like putting to words, like, and images, the things that we think about, picture, in order to try and emotionally prepare ourselves. It's a weird kind of fantasy.
It really is, knowing that we can't not be prepared, right?
Yeah.
You know, knowing that that's impossible. You know, and Freya, you're like so on it with what you're saying about what happens with cameras, right? Like, I think of cameras as catalytic, mm-hmm. because I think when you introduce a camera, everyone knows the camera represents the future.
Yeah.
And so, you know, that's why people are nervous about being on camera. Because, and I think this is changed, right? And it's changed for me, and it's certainly changed for many of us. You know, it used to be when it was so rare to be filmed, you'd be like, this is it. Like, my hair has to be perfect. I can't make a mistake in anything I say because this image will represent me for forever. You know, in fact, there's a lot of versions of Kirsten Johnson out there in the world, right? Like, I am fragmented into pieces. And even if I say something now that I regret, it could damn me forever. Like, that is true. You can say something that will damn you for the rest of your life and you can never recover from if it is recorded and put out into the world. That is true. And also, there's this sort of new freedom in their multiple presentations of myself. But all of that to say, you know, I remember I was really afraid in my early life of filming either of my parents, because the implication is, if I am filming you, it is because I'm imagining you will die. Right? I want to record your story. And this is when people go to film their grandparents, or like, why they wait to film their parents until suddenly it's too late to film their parents.
Yeah.
Because you don't want to say, I am imagining your death. But the camera's presence is saying, the future will come when you will not be here, and only this image will remain.
And it's so interesting how different kinds of people have that, like, express that in different ways. You're a filmmaker and an artist, so this is how you express, I am beginning to confront your inevitable death. I was thinking about, like, from the age of like 12, my grandmother started to just give me all the shit in her house. She, every time I visited, she was like, you like that? Take it. And I was like, I know. And even at a young age, I understood she was imagining a future in which she did not need things because she was not on this earthly plane. And it's such a great, like, such a human experience that, like, that regardless of age or like the way in which that's being expressed, you're like, oh God, it's that moment. It's that moment where we're dealing with the fact, we're dealing with mortality.
That's right.
In whatever capacity we can.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So we have a, we've got a question from the audience, which is one of the fun things about this format. I'm going to read it. It's from Nicole. Were the Jacques Tati and Buster Keaton influences a part of the documentary from the start?
Oh, yes. Yes. You know, I discovered Jacques Tati when I was in France, and, you know, I'm a visual person. So to like see sound driving a movie, I was like, what is happening? It was like learning a whole new language. And, you know, the precision of it was, you know, sort of thrilling to me. And I also knew it was not for me, like that I couldn't ever have that kind of precision and control like Tati does. And yet, you know, one of the things I remember learning in film school was that Jacques Tati hired someone to follow dogs for a year and just see what they did. And then he culled from those things like ideas about what dogs could do in his movies. And you know, I was like, oh, that's my groove. You know, and so I think the difference of his world to my world was a revelation. And then Buster Keaton, for me, it's just like, it's a love affair, you know, like on the level of my face is doing like everything, and his face is just like, and to experience that much and still have the face do that, like that is also this world I can barely imagine. But you know, like how deep that this person is just hurtling his body into these situations, you know, at great cost to his body. And like, just so much of it. Like, it's just like, he's done one thing, then it's another thing. No, you know, all of that, you know, and we just keep rewatching and rewatching The General and trying to figure out like, why was he on the Confederate side? Like, you know, like how can I love this man so much? And he was on the Confederate side. Like, this is America, right? Like, this is the pain of America. Like, some of the things that we love the most are like, how are they so wrong? You know, so like that sort of struggle with Buster Keaton, I feel like I'm like constantly engaged with it. Mm-hmm. So yes, and I like, I feel in love with him. Mm. And that often happens to me when I film. I just like literally like, oh, I'm in love with you. I want to just look at you forever. So I love when I experience that in a movie. You know, all these sleepless nights, like I'm in love with them, you know, and cinema can, like, it's such a rare experience to truly fall in love with someone. And then that cinema can do it. Like, you're just like, wait, how is that possible? And yet I can't, it's not for me. Mm-hmm. Right.
So speaking of films that you love.
Yeah.
And coming back to the theme today a little bit.
Yeah.
What is your particular brand of like leaning in emotionally? If you're like, I have this feeling, I gotta get it out. What is it you're seeking out to?
Okay, like, so that's so interesting because I wouldn't say I know I have the feeling and I have to release it. Again, I don't know. I don't know how much I'm feeling, mm-hmm. and the film allows it.
So it's instinct or
folks, you know, I think, you know, I'm a naturally curious person. Mm-hmm. But for example, Jackass, like I
love Jackass.
I love Jackass.
Love.
And Jackass like hurts so bad. It's so messed up. And the scatological stuff like makes me laugh, like in a hysterical way.
Yeah.
Hysterical. I did that in Ratatouille too, when the rats enter the kitchen. I was laughing hysterically and I was just like, I don't even know what this is. But so that like hysterical high pitched laughter, and then Jackass where it's just like, it's like laugh upon laugh and you can't stop yourself. That thing, I'm just like, anytime I can get that, I want.
Yeah. Well, right. And also that, like, speaking of things that, you know, because the three of us are also critics, they're, I'm like very fascinated by things that I don't know how to describe. I'm like, I don't know. I can just tell. And I know that's, I could never put that in a review because it doesn't hold weight and you can't defend it. But my sense with Jackass and why I like it so much better than anything else that's in the genre of like men, I don't know, like punching each other for fun or whatever, is like, I don't know. They seem like it's fun for them. And that makes the whole experience so different. And I think, weirdly, I was not expecting this connection. Hmm. But then, you know, what you described about making Dick Johnson has that quality where you're like, it's gonna hurt, but it felt great somehow, yeah. You know?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I remember once being on an airplane and talking to my, you know, I'm one of those people, like, I don't provoke the conversation, but sometimes
it comes to you.
Quiet until like it's happening. But you know, it turned out this is one of those guys who flies in those squirrel suits. You know, those like suits you put on and it's like a death wish, you know, like you jump off a cliff and all you're wearing is like lycra. And I was like, no, you are not kidding me. And so we get into it, and of course it's like, you know, he worked in Guantanamo, abusive father, like man has been suicidal all of his life. And on a certain level, can't kill himself to save his life, you know, like, and so like, of course, he's gonna fly in a squirrel suit. And that conversation, you know, it's like, that's what I feel about the Jackass guys. Like, they come from some messed up, they come from hurt. And they found each other and they love each other.
Yeah.
But they also like punk each other with a delicious, like, you know, like the way big brothers like beat up little brothers or little sisters, right? And there's something to that that, you know, really speaks to me. And I know, like, on a certain level, it's not okay. Like, that's not the okay way to deal with violence. And yet it's, And that's the transgression.
But it is for them. Like, if it is for them, then also who are we to say that's not okay in a way?
Yeah. And also, you know, I think there are ways in which people have suffered in this life, you know, and I'll take the fictional character in A Little Life. I don't know if you all managed to read that book, but.
Oh my God.
I instantly gave it away when I was done. I said, get this out of my house. I gave it away. I gave it to the pie shop.
Absolutely crushing. And everybody told me that. I was like a latecomer, so it's not like I didn't know. And I was like, yeah, okay.
I can handle it.
I make docs.
Yeah. No, and for people, like, you're like, okay, that's not okay, right? Yeah. But a person is carving themselves into pieces because someone else has abused them.
Yeah.
Right? So I do think there are ways in which people hurt themselves as a way of coping with pain that is not healthy for themselves, right?
You're right.
And I don't support that. Like, it's not all good, right? Like, it's not all good. And people kill themselves, right?
No, that you're completely right. I should clarify by saying there's a way in which there's a way in which it feels like maybe it is kind of help. There's a strange kind of community. There doesn't seem to be long-lasting damage, and that they get something out of the experience that they wouldn't otherwise.
Well, let's talk about Sick. Let's talk about Kirby Dick's Sick.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, that movie, I remember seeing it at MoMA. I was by myself, and me and this man sitting next to me were just like, oh my God. And we went out for drinks afterwards to like process what we had just
seen. You needed to talk about it.
We had to talk about it. But, you know, that a person who, you know, living with cystic fibrosis, which is like a wrenchingly painful disease, find sadomasochism as a way to have agency over like their own body. And, you know, like respect for that.
Yeah.
Respect for his sense of humor, respect for his willingness to share it with all of us and to blow my mind for permanently, right? So, you know, I do think humans find ways to deal with their pain.
Well, I was just going to say my fiction example of what you're describing is Secretary, which I weirdly think about much more than I expected. It's not like I necessarily loved the film or thought it was exceptional, but I went with some friends. I was in college, and I remember some people's response was like, gross. Like, she has a problem. And I was like, well, yeah, but we all have problems. I don't know. There's something about it that's like, feels neither like it's condoning nor judging. They're like, this is this person's needs. This is currently the best way that they're able to address those needs.
Mm-hmm.
And everyone's alive, so that's cool.
It's kind of like almost every Michael Haneke film. You're just like, okay, wow, you got a bunch of broken glass in your pocket. Okay, you know, like,
I should add, very interestingly, we had a recent happy hour where we talked about comfort films, and one of our guests picked The Piano Teacher as a comfort film.
Whoa!
Which is super interesting. Yeah, she just watches it whenever she wants to, you know. She's probably watching now. Maybe you're watching now, Sue.
Wow.
She wants to feel something. But I find it super fascinating that when we started talking about films that we find cathartic, we've gone to the dark side first. We've gone
immediately.
Cathartic and pain.
Right. I'm not much of a horror person, but, you know, like, I will return to Jordan Peele over and over again, you know, like, return to Get Out, return to, like, just like Us, like, you know, the, what's packed into that is so, like, worth, like, re-engaging with all the time, and I mean, I think I was such a good girl for so much of my life. Like, I was so raised to be a good girl that movies were the first place. And like, literally, as I said, you know, Mel Brooks' Young Frankenstein, it was literally like, you can say those are big knockers. Like, you know, like, I was like, what? You know, it was so thrilling that like tiny transgression was so thrilling to me. And so that films, that it can be in the transgressive space. And, you know, this is what's interesting about the difference between a film that is wholly in the zone of performance, as opposed to a film that's wholly in the zone of evidence.
Mm-hmm.
My new words. I'm working on new. I'm so over
new word
human fiction.
Can we? I appreciate that.
Come up with some new words.
Yeah,
that should be the project for next year because it is like it's tired.
It's and so tired.
And then like scripted sounds so like weird networky language and also irrelevant. Like Jeff and I have had difficulties because we have a documentary with a lot of writing and people are always confounded. And I'm like, I don't understand what's so hard about this. Like you understand these kinds of things exist. We just used a few of them together.
Yeah. What are all of your words? What would you choose? Would you just say movie? What would you say?
Yeah, I like movie. Yeah, movie, films. I tend not to like the word documentary anymore. I'm kind of over documentary. I can live with nonfiction. Mm. I think that maybe cuts a little bit closer to the heart of the thing in a certain way. Because like to me, documentary is like a part of nonfiction.
Right.
In a sense.
Non-anything feels so like, what? Like, what the why with that? Like, you know, like.
Suddenly popped into my head is the title of that Chick Strand film, Soft Fiction. I think that's a more accurate and more poetic way of describing what documentary is, which is like, it's all crafted. And similarly, with you know, like Dick Johnson is because there are moments that are very explicitly crafted for the film that draw that out. It's like, well, even if you hadn't done an incredible musical number, of course, there's the aspect of which scenes you use, how it's edited, and how you drive the conversation and all of that. But so I like the idea of like, it's a kind of fiction. It's a soft fiction. Soft butch, I don't know.
Arrival of Eric Hines, soft fiction purveyor.
Hello.
Hello.
Arrival of Eric Hines.
Jonsi's striped shirt today.
Are you the like harbinger of death? Are you like, and now your time on this earth is done, KJ?
When Eric appears, it's over.
I like to ease into the space and we can spend as long as we'd like. I'm either your safety valve to end or I'm your promise for a little bit more, whichever way you want to go.
You're literally all things as usual. Like
I am soft fiction right here.
Michael, you know, when you all said catharsis, I immediately said Cabaret Bob Fosse and you were like, yes. So I want to hear about your relationship to that movie, which we just recently watched, and it blew my mind and reminded me a lot of I May Destroy You. No!
Sorry, I just dropped something. But I had to show that to you.
Had you seen it before?
Not even a plant.
Had you seen it before? Was this a first viewing?
I saw it in France, so I hadn't seen it for, you know, 25 years. And it was really fun to watch it with kids.
Yeah.
Our son is currently obsessed with World War II. And so, you know, it was really sort of juicy and interesting to watch it with them. But I was just like so amazed by these, like, just like you just sort of crash into these like really emotional moments, you know, like in I May Destroy You, where it's just like, oh. Like,
we're there.
Boom. We're in a new landscape. Of emotion.
Yeah, no, it's a film that's been very important to me for a very long time. My mom showed it to me when I was probably 10, between maybe 8 and 10. And
like I did. So
yeah, you did you did the right thing. You did
our 8-year-olds, yes.
And it hit me on a couple levels. I mean, I think, you know, it first of all, young burgeoning queer kid, realizing his love for Liza Minnelli, that's big, that's major, that's huge. At the exact same time, it's the most terrifying movie about like the rise to power of the Nazis you could ever show a child, because you're constantly in this space where you're negotiating between joy, you know, rhythmic passion, amazing songs, you're tapping your toes, you're out of your chair, and then every single time you're feeling something great, it cuts to something horrifying. Yeah. So I think that it was like a real seminal film for me, because I was negotiating these registers at the same time. So when Tomorrow Belongs to Me happens, you know, when the Aryan blonde youth start singing in the garden and everyone starts to join in, as you know, perfect metaphor for the, you know, the rise of fascism. I got it. I was 8 years old, but I got it. I remember getting chills. I remember starting to cry and being very, very scared. Cause when you grow up, I say the third thing, you know, I'm Jewish, and I grew up in a house where my parents talked about the Holocaust all the time. They talked about Nazis, they talked about World War II. First time I had ever seen it dramatized, and especially in such a way. I mean, I realized later it was unique. So it was hitting me on, it was just like punching me on every possible level over and over again. And I think it's a movie that I've had to revisit over and over and over again in my life. Sometimes I put a scene on because I want to hear Liza Minnelli sing the song Cabaret, which is complete catharsis, mm-hmm. and that's just pure joy. And then sometimes I watch it because I want to lean into the pain. It's everything at once.
Yeah, I mean, Farihah, I just like, I mean, Liza Minnelli, she is living so hard. Mm-hmm. You're just like, how do I be that alive? You know, that was like, you know, the kids are like, whoa, she really gives it her all.
And that's like, entirely what the song is about. I remember, so Michael, Jeff and I, and Michael's husband, Christopher, watched Cabaret together, one of the many times that I've also watched it. Oh. And we love it. We sing along. We know the music. When the final number comes on, I've never watched it with somebody and heard them sing along. You do not sing Cabaret with Liza. You just listen. And it's like the most, like one of the most consistently engaged with cinema experiences that I have, where I can watch it for the 15th time and I still am like, this thing is happening.
Now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think, have you ever watched All That Jazz?
Yeah, of course.
Okay. Because it also
influenced Dick Johnson is Dead.
I would imagine, I thought about it a lot because it has this incredible fantasy musical death sequence that I think about all the time. That like the subjectivity of your own death and how other people experience your death can be like uniquely expressed in cinema. It's not just the cold hard facts, right? It's like what, if you had to give it form, what would it be like? This massive stuff that's happening up here.
Yeah. And that you can choreograph emotions, right? Like this choreography of emotions. It's so just, like you were saying, like it is live experience every time you engage with it.
I find All That Jazz very cathartic. And even though he's an imperfect person, like all of us, and also a very hard liver, I hadn't thought about it this way, but like I find that to be a totally joyous death, even as he's contending with the things that he'd wished he'd done better in his life and reflecting this way. Basically, I just wish like Ben Vereen would sing me unto death. That's a pretty good way to go.
But I was, if you don't mind, I think perfect thing to lead into what I was going to say about Dick Johnson is Dead, which is I think that, and you don't have to accept this, KJ, you don't have to agree with this angle. But I think that both of your films are inbuilt works of criticism too, where you're actually critiquing the image and critiquing how films are made. And I think that with Dick Johnson is Dead, there's not a moment there that you haven't kind of worked over the power of images or the limited power of images in filmmaking. And when I was thinking about catharsis, my first thought was to think of a negative act of catharsis that I see in cinema, which is that attempt so often to signal to the audience that they're supposed to love your main character. And what you're going to signal to them is in the last scene, you're going to have everybody give them a standing ovation. And that's what you get to say, as complicated as this guy may have been, he was amazing. Let's all give him a round of applause, you know? And not to give anything away, but there is a scene of such in your film, which I think you entirely invert it. Because it winds up being about the people applauding more than it's about the person who's being applauded. And you kind of, you know, like to use an English term, you kind of take the piss a little bit out of that moment, even though it's an incredibly cathartic, meaningful moment. And so you kind of make us look at what a scene like that in our lives or in cinema, actually what, you know, the limitations it might have as well as the power of it. Just extraordinary.
I love the idea of inbuilt. Yeah, there's definitely a lot inbuilt with this movie. You know, it's so funny because I'm always like with that thing around like, oh, you have a critical mother and you're struggling with criticism and you're trying to, you know, like that relationship to critical. And, you know, you all make me love criticism, you know, that like in some ways, like, you know, all of this work that is done in therapy, engaging with the critical parent that some of us had, right? My mother, in my case, my father, not a critical parent at all. Like everything I did was like, this is the best thing ever. You know, Dick Johnson is dead. The movie was a success for him before it was made because I was going to make it, right? He was like, why are you making a movie about me? And I was like, well, I'm not really making a movie about you, Dad. Like, it's about time and death. And he was like, fine. You know, like, but I think this like your love of the critical that you all express in all the work that you do and in the way that you love cinema reminds me that like, yeah, I got built in, like, criticism is part of my game too, you know, criticism of self, criticism of images, criticism of like, what is this folly of our narcissism that we're all involved in, right? And can we just somehow find a way to save ourselves from the madness of the world? Thanks for reminding me that. I like the inbuilt criticism.
We've got another question, which I'd love to put out there as before we wrap up with time. This is from Connor. And they say, as a first-time doc filmmaker, I'm finding myself struggling to write narration on a personal doc. I was wondering if you have any tips/wisdom on how you found your voice in your films, which is interesting because in Cameraperson, there is no narration.
Oh, there's a little bit. I mean, there's a little bit of video. There's a little bit. Connor, I feel your pain. It is literally one of the hardest things in the world to do. And it is in doing it that you will understand what you're trying to do. So for example, you know, I resisted doing any voiceover on Dick Johnson is Dead until people started saying to me, like, you know, you're throwing your dad under the bus, like he's totally exposed and you're protecting yourself. I was like, damn. So then, you know, I would like write these really long things and Nels would say, okay, well, record it. And then, you know, I would record this like 3-minute long thing and Nels would be like, where do you want to put that? and I would talk to myself in the closet, you know, like I live in this one bedroom apartment at the time I was making the movie. And my father was, you know, outside of the closet, and I would talk into the phone, record myself, and like Dad would knock on the door and interrupt me, like, what are you doing in there? And so there's this like amazing thing where his dementia helped me get to it, helped like us write shorter and shorter things because he would interrupt me so quickly that I had to be like, okay, well, instead of like, whoa, talking all around it, boom, let me get to it. So there's like this really interesting thing around sort of the compression that dementia forced on all of us in this process of like, okay, going straight to the heart of it. Cause you know, my dad's like different relationship to time means I have no time to say my long-winded thing. But get so that you can both be in your deepest emotion and stand outside of yourself and be like, oh, that was a lousy take, or that was an interesting take, which is like crazy that you can do that. But if you do it enough, don't try to get it right. You'll never get it right. And in general with filmmaking, like, just know you're failing. It's fine. Fail.
Always. Always failing.
Always fail. That's what, you know, that's what great camera people do, is like, know, like, just comfortable with failing every day, with having missed the best work every day. We miss the best stuff, right, Jeff? Every single day.
Always, you never see it happen behind you.
You promise, like, you had that shot of the buffalo, like, galloping towards you. Oh, oops, I turned off the camera. You know, like, it always happens. So be kind to yourself, though. Be kind, because what you're doing is really, really hard work. Connor.
I think we have our toast.
I just want to say that KJ brought the buffalo charging at Jeff, and Jeff definitely looks like he could have a buffalo charging at him right now.
Yes.
I think we should toast to failing every day.
Mm-hmm. Please.
Beautiful.
Failing and loving all of us who fail. Like, loving everyone in our lives who's failing us, including ourselves, right?
I like fully agree, and I'm also stressed out. Yeah. Just hearing it. Yeah. We have to live with that. It's okay.
Sorry. You know how
I No, talk. It's just true. It's just exactly true.
Speaking of people who are not failing us by showing up and hanging out with us during this hour, Reverse Shotters, Jordan Cronk, Julian Allen, Ryan Swen, Susanna Gruder, Caden Mark Gardner, Devika Girish. Devika, congratulations on everything with New York Film Festival right now. And I also want to shout out, since KJ is here, a fellow camera person tuning in tonight, Martin DeChico.
Martin.
And with that, anything else?
You know, just that I really love and respect you all. And I love the community that you are like fostering in our beautiful corner of the soft fiction world. inbuilt criticism and catharsis to us all.
There's so many good toasts. Thank you for joining our community. Cheers.
Much love to all, and long may you live.